Hi everyone! This topic has come up in a lot of previous videos, so I figured it deserved a video of its own. I think this debate over whether we should be focusing on individual change or systemic change is an example of the pendulum effect. When too much focus is placed on one narrative, the pendulum swings in the opposite direction, and that narrative is rejected entirely. We see this in both the environmental movement and the vegan movement. Dating back to the 50s, corporations began to hijack the environmental movement, intentionally steering the focus to individual action, abandoning responsibility and placing it solely onto the consumer. The Keep America Beautiful campaign, a prime example of this strategy, released this ad in 1971.
Some people have a deep, abiding respect for the natural beauty that was once this country. And some people don't. People start pollution. People can stop it. Write for Pollution Booklet, Box 1771, Radio City Station, New York.
For a while, well-intentioned environmentalists took the bait and put their focus on promoting individual changes such as recycling, biking, and buying more efficient light bulbs. The left rightfully critiqued this framing, shining a spotlight on corporations and the capitalist system. But some people have taken this message too far and see little value in promoting individual change. They think it's counterproductive and problematic. They criticize people for promoting individual behavior change. As of late, the focus of the animal rights movement has largely been on educational vegan outreach. Think speeches, street conversations, YouTube videos. There are activists pushing for us to shift focus from the demand side to the supply side. In other words, they argue that we should be disrupting the industry rather than trying to influence consumer behavior. There is valid criticism in placing too much focus on this approach, but what I see is the pendulum swinging in the opposite direction. Now, there are people who view street outreach as the wrong approach. Promoting individual change is viewed as a waste of time or a missed opportunity to promote systemic change. Supporting activists who do this type of outreach on Patreon is a waste of money. As a proponent of both systemic change and individual change, I think this attitude is misguided. These are not conflicting frameworks, they reinforce each other. Before we get into how, I want to highlight the key differences between the environmental movement and the vegan movement. Environmentalism is about reduction. Pollution is only harmful in excess. Veganism, however, is about the abolition of animal exploitation. Exploitation is harmful, period. The messaging should be different. It's not immoral to buy a single plastic bottle. It's irresponsible to regularly buy stuff like bottled water. The harm caused by plastic is indirect. A plastic straw is not guaranteed to kill a sea turtle. In fact, it's unlikely to cause harm at all. But animal products are in a different category because the production involves direct harm. Harm is an inherent part of the process. Therefore, there is a greater moral obligation to go vegan. Also, the way our capitalist system is structured, it may be possible to avoid plastic, but it's not practicable for the majority. The same goes for going carless. In certain areas, the public transportation and biking infrastructure is so poor that placing responsibility on individuals is unfair. In comparison, it is much more practicable to avoid the products of animal exploitation. Structurally, going vegan is a significantly easier lifestyle change to make. Lastly, the environmental movement and the vegan movement are at different places regarding public opinion. More people are on board with systemic change to address the climate crisis than are on board with systemic change to abolish animal exploitation. For this reason, it makes sense for the vegan movement to put more energy and effort into educational outreach than the environmental movement. Vegans are still a tiny percentage of the population, and we need to shift the Overton window before broad system change is even possible. From the article, Debunking the False Choice Between Individual Behavior Change and Systems Change, In any society, individuals drive social norms that make up the collective culture. For instance, cultural revolutions don't happen because of system change. They happen when a group of people voice a compelling story that propagates across society and becomes a social norm. In other words, individual change is the precursor to systemic change. Systemic changes can help create an environment more conducive to widespread attitude change. But systemic change alone does not create attitude change. It must coincide with efforts to change people's attitudes. The prohibition of alcohol in the United States is a great example of what happens when a minority forces systemic change without public support. We can advocate for a bigger focus on systemic change without devaluing individual change. Examples of systemic changes we can fight for are slashing meat and dairy subsidies, making schools and hospitals more plant-based, banning advertising for processed meat, banning fur, foie gras, animals in circuses, etc. Welfare reforms such as banning cages, crates, mutilation, and branding increase the cost of doing business, driving up the cost for consumers. The more expensive, the less appealing to the majority. I think this impact outweighs the potential harm of making people more comfortable with animal exploitation. But this potential harm is why we shouldn't abandon educational outreach efforts that promote a clear vegan message. This system change rhetoric often coincides with reducitarian rhetoric in vegan spaces. Supposedly, establishing veganism as the moral baseline drives a wedge between us and other movements. And this is a bad thing because we need the support of other social justice movements to win. But to truly win, we need other social justice advocates to genuinely embrace the idea of animal liberation, not just certain policies that reduce harm to animals. And to get there, we have to talk openly and honestly about speciesism. This will cause division. There's no way around it. We should avoid division where we can, but also recognize that some division is a natural part of the process. We shouldn't be so fixated on unity that we sacrifice the integrity of our message. Going vegan is the least we can do. It's the bare minimum. Like, I don't get how expecting people to stop contributing to the problem is hurting the cause. Meaningful systemic change requires a lot of effort. It requires dedication and commitment and organization. It's much easier to simply avoid funding animal abuse than to volunteer your time and continue to show up for a sustained pressure campaign. Who are all these vegan allies willing to join us in this fight but unwilling to go vegan? These people who were supposedly pushing away by promoting veganism as a moral obligation. I don't know a single person who lacks the motivation to go vegan, but has the motivation to get involved in political work for farm animals. We can build alliances with other movements without watering down the animal rights message. For example, we can harness support from the environmental movement to get rid of meat and dairy subsidies, while maintaining that veganism is the moral baseline in our animal advocacy. There is utility in framing animal agriculture as an environmental or public health issue in certain contexts. Apart from being an animal rights issue, it is an environmental and public health issue. We can appeal to environmentalists by talking about the environmental harm caused by animal agriculture. We can appeal to school boards by talking about the health consequences of meat and dairy. But in the context of animal advocacy, there is no utility in promoting reducitarianism. All this does is reinforce speciesism. If we're critiquing a narrative, we should be careful not to throw the baby out with the bathwater. We can demand change from institutions and encourage others to do the same, without using language that disempowers individuals, such as, individual behavior change is a drop in the bucket, it's like pissing in the ocean. Or language that disempowers activists, such as, educational outreach efforts fail to produce results, and asking people to change their behavior doesn't work. Here's a beautiful example from Animal Rebellion's website. We are about political change and system, not personal change. We welcome personal change, however, it is not a requirement for joining Animal Rebellion. We value all organizations working on individual lifestyle changes, however, we see our unique role to demand broader system change from the UK government. We aren't focused on traditional systems of campaigning, such as petitions or writing to our MPs. Again, we honor this work that is currently being done, and we are not trying to replace or erase that. We cannot do it all, so we focus on our unique role within this ecosystem of social movements, which is mass, nonviolent civil disobedience. Whoever wrote that, hats off to you. Thank you for not devaluing the important and necessary work other activists are doing to promote individual behavior change. Lastly, I want to touch on this mantra, blame the system, not the consumer. Are consumers not a part of the system? Corporate executives hold a larger share of responsibility than the average consumer, but each individual has some degree of responsibility, and that share is what we should hold people accountable for. We're not blaming individuals for the entirety of the problem. We're blaming them for their contribution to the problem. If something is outside of your control, or the more ethical choice is exceedingly difficult to the point where it's impractical, then it's reasonable to blame the system. It makes sense to place more blame on wealthier consumers, because the easier it is to make an ethical choice, the more you are expected to do so. Poverty makes choices more difficult, and in some cases, it takes choice away. But the word consumer encompasses everyone. That's why this rhetoric that portrays consumers as merely victims of the system is so irritating to me. Where you have the choice in what you consume, your consumption makes you complicit. And as a side note, the phrase, "there is no ethical consumption under capitalism," is meant to expose capitalism's inherent flaws. It is not meant to justify any and all consumption. It is impossible to cause zero harm, especially in a system where exploitation is inherent. But we should strive to cause the least amount of harm possible. Of course, some people are hyper-focused on their individual behavior to their own detriment. In other words, they overestimate their impact, and this produces undue stress. If you're riddled with guilt over a plastic fork or an animal ingredient you didn't notice, chill out. You don't need to carry the weight of the world on your shoulders. But I think most people use this system change rhetoric as an excuse to evade personal responsibility. And vegans use it to placate carnists because they've been gaslit into believing that they are in the wrong if they make people feel guilty. Anyway, by evading responsibility as a consumer, you are reflecting the behavior you despise. You hate corporations for putting profit over principles, yet by eating meat and buying things like bottled water, you're putting fleeting pleasure and convenience over your principles.
Why waste precious time arguing about what and who needs to change first? Everyone and everything has to change, but the bigger your platform, the bigger your responsibility. The bigger your carbon footprint, the bigger your moral duty.
In Greta's eyes, of course, we were missing out one big point, in fact, the most important point, which was the climate or the sustainability crisis going on around us. So while we were saying all these things about, you know, taking care about our fellow man, we were flying around, eating meat and buying things and driving a big car, having two homes, and of course, that's not really sustainable. And then we realized that we were, of course, a huge part of the problem. In fact, we were the problem. Also, a very central thing is that we say we need, a system change, so we should not be doing this as a private consumer. But there is no politics. There are no politics to solve the situation we're in today. There's not one single political party that I know of that will solve this crisis. And, you know, so we need to create a whole new thing. And that's why we also need to lead by example. We may not like it, but in today's social climate, you need to live as you preach. Live as you...
Practice as you preach. Practice as you preach.
Yo, how when me eat, them I wonder when me eat. When me tell them, say me no eat no fish, nah, no meat now. How when me eat, them I wonder when me yum. When me tell them, say that I'm a vegan man. How when me eat, them I wonder when me eat.